Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel for the video lectures of theory genealogy. Myself Dr. B.L. Kumawat. I am working as a subject matter specialist and I teach theory genealogy in the College of Veterinary and Animal Sciences, Parbhani, under Maharashtra Animal and Fishery Sciences University, Nagpur, Maharashtra. So I come prepared with my second lecture on obstetrics upon your request. In previous lecture, we have discussed about maternal recognition of pregnancy, and the next step is the implantation. Now, today we will discuss about implantation, placentation, and conceptus development. So, coming back to the PowerPoint presentation, here in the slide you can see the early stages of development within the reproductive tract. And the site of fertilization is ampullary stomach junction, where the male gamete spermatozoa is fertilizing the female gamete ovum and forming the unicellular structure zygote. Immediately after the formation of zygote, it enters into the cleavage divisions and it becomes morula, then blastocyst, then gastrula, and so on. So, during these early stages of development, this early embryo is rolling down the oviduct and it enters into the uterus at around day 4 to 5. Although this period of uterine descent of the embryo varies among different species. And once it enters into the uterus, it stays for some days. And then the blastocyst hatches out from the zona pellucida cell and it becomes a free floating structure within the uterus, and after some couple of days it attaches with the wall of uterus, and the process is called as implantation. So we go into the detail of each and every stage of early embryonic development. But before going into the details of developmental biology, we must clarify some confusing terms which are used interchangeably most of the time with overlapping meaning. But definitely they differ in their real sense. So the first term is ovum. Ovum is a mature haploid female gamete. The next term is uterus. Uterus is a fertilizing ovum, means it is in the process, in the path of fertilization, and a particular stage where it is containing the separate male and female pronucleus in its cytosol. Once the syngamy process, that is the union of male and female pronucleus, it is over, the syngamy is over, there is formation of zygote. And this zygote is defined as unicellular diploid structure formed by the fertilized ovum after the process of syngamy. Then embryo. Embryo is defined as an organism in its early stage of development. From the onset of cleavage divisions in the zygote till the stage of gastrulation, where there is formation of organs, or it is also called as organogenesis. So one of the most important characteristic of embryo is that by morphological appearance we cannot recognize this embryo as a member of a particular species. Now, just by external look at a glance we can't identify that whether this embryo is related with the equine species, or it belongs to the bovine species, or it belongs to the canine species. The next term is fetus, a more advanced form of embryo post-gastrulation to the end term, that is easily recognizable as the member of a particular species. Means just by morphological appearance we can easily identify that yes, this is the equine embryo, or this is a bovine embryo, or this is a canine embryo. Next term is conceptus. Conceptus referred to the product of conception. Conception means getting pregnant, getting conceived, means whatever content is synthesized or formed additionally in a gravid uterus as we compare to the non-gravid uterus, non-pregnant uterus, what is the additional things are formed, are synthesized in the pregnant uterus? That is called as conceptors. It's definitely in a pregnant uterus, you will find embryo or fetus proper. Apart from fetus, there are some extra embryonic membranes and fetal fluids. So all these things, fetus, extra embryonic membranes and fetal fluids, they are cumulatively called as conceptors. Now the next term is neonate. Neonate is a mature fetus born newly at the term. So here you can see the early developmental stages in domestic animals at a glance. Here you can see unicellular zygote, then cleaving zygote, or you can say the morula stage, then the blastula stage and hatching of the blastocyst. Immediately after fertilization, this unicellular zygote enters into the cleavage divisions and it descends downwards and enters into the uterus at around day 3 to 4 in cattle. There is around day 5 to 8 in dog and cat. And at this particular time, it is consisting of 16 to 32 cells, and this stage is referred as morula. With further cell divisions in the morula and cell reorientation, the morula becomes hollowed out to form a blastocyst, which is consisting of inner cell mass or embryonic knot or embryonic disc or embryoblast. All these terms are synonymous to each other. So this is the one part of blastocyst. The another part is trophoblast, that is the peripheral cellular part, cellular bunch, and the cavity, which is regarded as blastocele. Now we'll see each and every detail of every stage of development. Here you can see the fertilizing ovum or ootid, which is having separate female and male pronucleus in its cytosol, and once the syngamy process is over, these pronuclei, they got merged with each other forming a single nucleus, and now it is regarded as zygote. So zygote is a unicellular diploid structure which is formed immediately after the process of syngamy. So these are the hand-drawn sketches, whereas in downward images you can see the real micrographs which are captured from electron microscope. And in the first image you can see there are two separate pronuclei, one is male and another is female pronuclei. So this particular stage is called as ootid. And once this syngamy process is over, you can see the submerging pronuclei, and this is the embryo. Now shortly after syngamy process, the zygote undergoes cleavage divisions and unicellular zygote is rendered into the two daughter cells, which are regarded as blastomeres. After the second cleavage division, these two daughter cells will be divided into 4, and then 4 to 8, 8 to 16, and 16 to 32, and so on. So ultimately, this early embryo is converted into a solid mass of blastomeres, which is containing around 16 to 32 cells. And this particular stage is called as morula. Now, why it is named as morula? Because it appears, it resembles in its appearance to a mulberry fruit, which looks like this. So, just because of its appearance, which is resembling to this mulberry fruit, it is named as morula. So, now, this morula is converted into a solid morula, it is converted into a hollowed structure. There is a formation of cavity. Now, how this transition of morula into early blastocyst takes place, you will see in detail. So, actually, there is formation of tight junctions in between the cellular surfaces of the peripheral cells. whereas there is formation of gap junctions in the central core part, core cells, and this leads to the formation of two separate bunches of the cells, two separate cellular populations. In the peripheral cells, the sodium ion is pumped out actively. And as you know, the water runs behind the minerals. When the sodium is pumped out from the cell, peripheral cells, into the intercellular spaces, obviously the water comes out from the cells into the intercellular spaces by the process of exosmosis. So the concentration of intercellular spaces is increased because of these sodium ions, and hence water follows the intercellular spaces, not only from the peripheral cells but also from the uterine fluids. Water also enters from the outside of the embryo through this zona pellucida, and this continuously constantly accumulating water into the early blastocyst leads to the increased pressure of water inside the morula. And what happens? Because of the loss of water, these peripheral cells, they become flattened. As there is increasing pressure, centrifugal pressure at the inner surface of the zona pellucida, and this increasing water pressure displaces the central core of cells eccentrically towards the one pole, and the peripheral cells got flattened. And here you can see there are two cellular populations, one is inner cell mass, another is trophoblast, and this cavity that is called as blastocene, it is filled with the water. Now the next event is blastocyst hatching. As you can see, this rapidly growing blastocyst hatches out of the external cell of zona pellucida, and it becomes a free floating embryo within the uterine lumen. So how this happens? What are the factors responsible for the hatching of blastocyst? You see in the next slide. There are mainly three driving forces which are responsible for the hatching of blastocyst. First is the growth of the blastocyst and fluid accumulation within the blastocyst cavity, which creates a centrifugal pressure. And the second important factor is production of enzymes by the trophoblastic cells. These trophoblastic cells produce some proteolytic enzymes which digest the zona pellucida layer, which is composed of glycoproteins, and it leads to the degradation and digestion of the layer, thereby forming a small slit or a fissure through the zona pellucida, and through which this blastocyst squeezes out and becomes a free floating embryo within the lumen of uterus. And now once it is in the uterus, it is entirely dependent on the uterine environment for its survival. And as we have studied in our previous lecture, that progesterone is very much essential to make the uterine environment conducive for the growth, nourishment and survival of the early embryo before implantation takes place. Implantation refers to the apposition or fusion of the extraembryonic membranes with the endometrium. Now, just after hatching of blastocyst, where are the extraembryonic membranes? Whether implantation takes place directly with the hatched blastocyst, or there is formation of some extra fetal membranes or extra embryonic membranes. We'll see the details of the formation of extra embryonic membranes in our next lecture. So this is all for today. Thank you everyone. Please give me your feedbacks. If you are feeling some improvement, frankly you can post your comments. थैंक यू।